Member from Essex.
Very much, Speaker. Pleased to have a little bit of time on the clock to address the concurrence and supply motion. Before I begin, Speaker, I want to give a shout out to our colleague, my partner in good work, in Windsor Tecumseh, Percy Hatfield is recovering from knee surgery. He's at home watching us all on TV intently, so everybody give him a big wave. Hi, Percy, we can't wait till you're back in here, and I'm sure he was texting us. And you know, I'm sure that if he had the ability today to stand and to speak to the supply motion, he'd have something prophetic or even poetic to say. I will be a lot maybe a lot more crass in my remarks here, Speaker. Frankly, the government to this point has continued on a pattern of failing this province in every measurable way. And people are seeing it more than they ever have. Perhaps it's because we have an old, tired government. 14 years. You get stale. You get into a pattern. And we're seeing it time and time again, where backbench members can yell from their seats total nonsense, not making one solid, valid point, and not standing up and adding to this debate. Speaker, people outside of this place are seeing it. They're seeing a government with no vision, with a reluctance to consult with the people that are affected by their policies. I'll give you one fact here. This is a fact that's indisputable. Today, it's reported that the government and the finance minister will release the budget next week. We had pre-budget consultations. They went into various communities around this province. They came down to Windsor. I'll talk about that a little bit. But the budget will be released and presented in this House without having the Finance Committee submit a report to this House, without tabling a report that encompasses the thoughts, the visions, the concerns of all Ontarians. You are ignoring completely the time that went into that. You are you don't care about what the people in this province are concerned about. You're ignoring it completely. To do otherwise, you know, you're signaling that through introducing this budget. To argue that fact, Speaker, it's indisputable. So what does that say to people in our communities? It says, frankly, they know best. They know what the priority should be of this province. They don't care about consultation. They don't care about the issues that our communities face. And one of the issues that we heard through the budget deliberations and the Finance Committee was that access to health care, one of the fundamental pillars of our society in our province, is becoming less and less accessible, frankly. People are concerned about primary care. The ability to find a doctor in their community still looms heavily, especially in remote and rural areas of this province where doctors are reluctant to set up. The access to long-term care, where seniors cannot find a bed, a place to go, despite all of the rhetoric we hear from the government on making any progress or effort on that. There still is a crisis. Long-term care, where we know there has to be an emphasis and an investment, continues to drag along and to not play the vital role in the system that we know it could, because the government continues to play games with our overall system. Given and juxtaposed under a Ministry of Finance that has frozen healthcare spending for the last 5 years. And in real term, real day dollars, that's an absolute cut. So hospitals, medium-sized hospitals are faced with a stagnant budget, increased costs. What are they to do? They've cut everywhere they can. I can tell you, I'm working with our healthcare leaders and administrators in Windsor and Essex County, and they'll show you the books. They'll show you where they've made the most efficiencies, and in fact they run on any metrics will show you that they are very efficient in the overall delivery of healthcare. But at a certain time, they simply, and given that they can't run a deficit, they're mandated, legislated not to be able to run a deficit, they have to cut frontline care, and that is directly on your conscience, or it should be, because it affects the health outcomes of our constituents and our communities. We're seeing it every day, Speaker. We're hearing the calls, but it's a government that doesn't care, and that's, again, reflective in the fact that they won't even table the report from Finance Committee before they release a budget. So we don't know what's going to be in there. We don't know what their priorities are, but we can ensure and we can be assured that they certainly won't reflect the needs and the desires of Ontarians. Speaker, I think you're giving me a little bit of a head nod because time is running. 1 or 2 minutes, it's tough to judge. Speaker, you know, you want to hear, I'll give you one example of where we've seen the fiscal prudence of this government. And this highlights, again, how inept they've been. The Pan Am Games, by any standard, by all accounts from the government and the ministry, Minister of the Pan Am Games, they were wildly successful. We learned after the Pan Am Games ended that the government saw fit to commission a hair salon for athletes at the Pan Am Games to the tune of $140,000 for 2 months. Is that how much it actually costs? Is that, in your mind, that's what haircuts cost these days? Because folks in my area certainly aren't paying their salons $140,000 or $70,000 a month for access to hair, you know, beauty supplies. Maybe some members of the backbench actually think that that's reasonable. But we would like to see, you know, on an annualized basis, Speaker, that's $840,000. And I asked the CEO of Windsor Regional Hospital, you know, what would you, David Mushe, what would you do with an extra $840,000? And he said, I would apply it directly to frontline care. That's where the priority is on the ground in communities. But by the Liberal standards, they want to invest in, they think it's important to ensure that there's access to manicures and pedicures and hair cutting services, not frontline nurses. How do you live with yourselves when your government is making decisions like that? And how do you go back to your community and actually make a case for a hair salon at to the tune of $140,000? It's reprehensible, Speaker, and it's an indication of a total collapse of confidence in this government and their fiduciary responsibilities. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you.